Wonderful. Just to see all of you together. So very happy and grateful for this opportunity to learn Bhagavad Gita together. I would like to begin with what we had done long back. We had started discussing on some contemplations that can help our chanting become better. So we had given an acronym. So, how many of you could recollect what were those contemplation triggers? H for? How in this world, internally and externally, we have unsurmountable challenges. Internally, there is lust, anger, grief, disappointments, frustrations. Externally, there are people, their demons, and unfulfilled, whatever, job related or family related. There's so many things that could make us helpless. Recently there was this earthquake in Nepal. It's a very helpless being condition in life. So, this material world is actually designed for sending us back to spiritual world. Why does somebody design a jail? To make people normal. Back again as normal citizens in the country. That is the purpose of the capital. So those who are disobedient to laws of God, they come to this material world. But they actually are meant to reform and go back to spiritual world. And for that purpose, the jail has to make some arrangement for reform and reformation and punishment. So Maya, Durga Devi, has got three shoes. What is threefold? Threefold miseries. Adhyatmik, Adhibhautik, Adhidaivik. So Adhyatmik is internal challenges. Adhibhautik, other living beings give us tough time. Bed bugs, HIV virus, malaria, whatever. Two, boss of the company, so on and so forth. So we have what happened? Adhibhautik misery. And then there is Adhidaivik misery coming from natural calamities which we cannot tackle. Tsunamis, tornadoes, typhoons, hurricanes, drought, flood. Difficult. So in this way, material world is designed for making us develop a sense of non-belongingness here and belongingness there in the spiritual world. So intelligent people utilize their freedom properly to develop this helplessness in the right manner. He is asking to shift here. You can come and sit here. You can come to the room. Are you sitting now?
Yes.
I can bring back. You can come and sit here. You need to sit up. Then you can sit there. Actually, it's a teacher. So when we are chanting Hare Krishna, Srila Prabhupada told us an interesting mode, like a baby crying for its mother, while you chant. Please accept me back into your arms. That's the mode in which baby cries. Helplessness. A form. Appreciation. So, we can appreciate a lot about the Holy Name. How God has made Himself so accessible to us. Generally, people are very thin. They don't make themselves so easily accessible. You know, President of America, big people. They make sure that they remain aloof and so-called maintain their stature. Krishna is not like that. He makes us easily access Him through His holy names.
So, one should develop appreciation for chanting, appreciation for the glory of the holy name, appreciation for the effects that the holy name has on the chanter, and appreciation for the experiences that the chanter goes through. Great acharyas, great saints, they have chanted the holy name of the Lord and they have experienced something. They have put their experience in various poems or songs. We should study scripture for that and develop our own unique appreciation for the holy name. So here we had only studied the effects part. I had told you about seven effects of chanting, beginning with the shloka Cheto Darpana Varjanam. Chanting makes the heart clean. Gehre se gehre daagon ko dho nikaalti hai. We create such terrible samskaras, impressions on our chitta, consciousness. But all those negativity samskara can be completely cleansed by the process of hearing the pure sound of holy name. So like that, we had studied seven, and I hope you remember, it's called Shikshashtakam, verse number 1 of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And in case you don't remember what I'm just now saying, then please be with me after the class. I'll show you the words and also you can take it down. R was for responsibility. One of the greatest reasons for our unhappiness in life is that we always are in a BMW mode. Blaming, moaning and wailing. Holding others responsible for our feelings and our condition. Because of somebody else, I am not happy. So whose responsibility is it to get us inspired, guided, facilitated, engaged, equipped? Our. It is not somebody else's responsibility. So when we come to spiritual life, we should learn to take 100% responsibility for our thoughts, words and actions. And at the time of Deeksha, when a pure devotee spiritual master gives us the holy name, we are actually taking an oath to maintain this chanting throughout our life. Till we die. Of course, a regulated quota of chanting. And that responsibility of that commitment should make us get inspired to continue practicing the process even in pleasant or unpleasant, favorable or unfavorable situations. That is how we mean a person is responsible. He is not a fair weather devotee. फेयर वेदर की कोटी आज बारिश हो रही है आज क्लास नहीं जाएंगे आज बारिश नहीं हो रही है लेकिन मैम हुई है तो क्लास नहीं जाएंगे सो यू नो माइंड प्लेस 100 ट्रिक्स इंडिया पाकिस्तान मैच हो रहा है जो भी सो रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी मीन्स इन एनी रिलेशनशिप यू हैव टू पुट असाइड अदर थिंग्स एंड गिव फुल प्रेजेंस. That is how we make a relationship stronger. So, we take that responsibility when we are chanting Hare Krishna. We are there, present. Not just body, but our mind with the Lord. And in this way, we take responsibility for our chanting and development of relationship with God. I for intention. What's our intent makes a big difference in what we get out of what we do. So, I give an example. How wife's birthday, husband has come home, he's preparing for going for a dinner with her, his friend calls, he says, will you come? We have a party in the office. Recently we completed a deadline. And he says, well, what can I do? I want to come, but I have to go for my dinner with my wife.
So if his wife hears time statement, you have to, not that you like to, you want to, you love to, but you have to.
She was thrashing for the whole lifetime, I guess.
Most probably. Not just that one dinner night. Similarly, when we sit for chanting, what's our mood?
Oh, I have to chant these rounds.
Not that we, I like to chant these rounds. I love to chant these rounds. I long for being with you, Lord, in the form of this meditation.
So that's why
what is our intent makes the very same object become appealing or unappealing.
Ye thama prapadyante tam stathaiva bhajami aham. As you approach me, I reciprocate with you accordingly,
Krishna says.
So one of the reasons why we don't get taste in spiritual life is because we are also not investing much. We are also wishy-washy in our commitment. And then you blame it on Krishna. He has made it so tough. So, intent. If you don't have right intentions, you will be in tension. Then N for need.
Have you studied this one?
No. It's very paused now. So we all have experience of needs. When you need something, when you need water.
Super thirsty.
When I came today in the class, I had not drunk water, I don't know since when. Not able to even speak.
Water.
Then we have need for appreciation.
Sometimes we are saying it's very general.
Sometimes we have need for, you know, dignified treatment. Like you see, so you go to the 5-star hotels, as soon as you park your car, 3 people are up. One for opening the door, one for greeting you with a shake hand, another for taking out your luggage from the behind. And as they're escorting you inside, somebody said it. So people feel dignified. So we have this very subtle, of course, often egoistic, centered on selfish desires, needs. And everyone in this world is not man. They are not man. They are simply working for fulfilling their own needs and values. That's all. Whoever is doing whatever, even a criminal, is actually just trying to fulfill some concocted need or value that he has developed in his system. And unless we develop a correct understanding of what our true needs are and what our original value system should be, we live a very miserable life. It's like a football being kicked in the ground of various, you know, lust, anger, pride, greed, envy, illusion. They kind of erupt in our heart varieties of needs and varieties of values. And our whole system is like helter-skelter. No orientation in life, practically speaking. But once we clearly decide how our true need is spiritual, we want to experience spiritual happiness, spiritual love, spiritual fulfillment. And when we try and work in that direction, then all other needs are taken care of. Just like, when I walk, my shadow walks behind me. Not that I walk ahead, shadow even somewhere around, go down behind it, catch up, okay, come. Similarly, spiritual well-being takes care of your material well-being also. We are not human beings having spiritual experience. We are spiritual beings having human experience. So why are we over-exaggerating our material needs in our life? Even cats and dogs, elephants and lizards get their eating, sleeping, mating, defending arranged in the creation. They don't need to go to IITs.
they don't need to work in some corporate corporation. And often they are quite happy.
You have seen elephants are healthy. Mm. One of the symptoms of happiness is you are fat.
Happy.
So think of it. Why should we as human beings let go our original prerogative, which is spiritual elevation in life, for animalistic things, just to make facility for that, which animals get without hard work, without much hard work. So in this way, a true spiritualist tries to understand what the true needs of the soul are and fulfills them. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the prototype devotee, a role model, in his Shikshashtakam prayer, he says, Shunyayitam Jagat Sarvam Govinda Virahenane. This whole world appears to me like a big zero in separation from Govinda. I don't know how many of you ever felt like that in your life. But without God, nothing has meaning in life. So when we want God that desperately, He is also very much eager to reciprocate. You heard that story, right? One student went to the elderly veteran spiritual teacher and he said, teach me about God, teach me about God. And he didn't answer much and he sent him away. And he pestered him very bad. Every day he would go and nag him very badly. And then one day he started arguing also, why are you not teaching me? I am trying my best to come and ask you sincerely again and again. So then he got up from his meditation, caught hold of that boy. Although he was an 80-year-old man, he was quite strong. And this boy took him into the river, pushed his head inside the water. And he was suffocating, gasping for oxygen. And took him out. Again dumped him inside. And he did that 2-3 times. He said, why are you trying to kill me? He said, now sit down. When you were there inside that water, how desperately you wanted air? He said, more than anything else. At that time, no thought of having food, or money, or prestige, or whatever was on my mind. He said, when you want God that desperately, you come to me. Now get lost. So it was like, oh, what kind of treatment is this? But don't worry, in our ISKCON we don't have such a thing, right? And that's why even I am practicing my spiritual life. I think all of us have a chance to take to Krishna consciousness. So the point I was making is, do we really feel that my true value or my true needs are spiritual in life? Or do we place great value and a great they call it unnecessities of life. One time Socrates had gone and he was found in a shopping mall. And his friends got shocked why this philosopher suddenly lost his track. Instead of being detached and composed, now he's running after worldly gadgets and goods. So they asked him, hey, why are you here? Socrates said, well, and he was found to be listing down things. Very seriously, he was noting down what is around in the mall. So he said, well, I was just making a list of things that people are purchasing here which we don't need at all. In the first place. And he gave an interesting logic. When you need something, you don't need to advertise it. Have you ever seen an advertisement? Water. Of course, nowadays there are packaged drinking water, that's a different stuff. But you don't advertise necessities. What do you advertise?
Unnecessities.
That which you don't need, that needs to be heavily advertised. Only the people will buy it. It's an interesting observation. In any case, we are supposed to feel need for Krishna. That's the point. So this need can be enhanced in the association of sincere spiritualists. Those who are really hankering after Krishna's association. So, I told you this earlier. One time Sri Prabhupada was walking around the bank of Stove Lake. I think it is in Los Angeles. And as they were having their morning walk in Chapantai, they saw that there were many ducklings in the water. And there was a mamma duck. And she had some food stuff in her mouth, beak. And she was coming towards them to feed them. Every one of them was quacking. So they were hungry, they wanted, feeling the need. But there was one small tiny little duckling. It was quacking like mad. So his mother just, finding the desperation, was given bed. And then what turned towards the disciple? What do you understand? So this what do you understand is a very interesting phenomenon. You are supposed to understand when you observe things, when you observe people, when you observe situations, often you miss the lesson. And catch hold of some unnecessary thing. So they said no. Kumbha said when you are chanting, this is how you should chant Hare Krishna. So everybody is quaking. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna, Hare Krishna. And some ducks there, they just quack because it's their duty to quack. Or some are quacking because what to do? A teacher, college teacher will come and every time will ask that question, are you chanting regularly? So, you know, those are not very interesting reasons for chanting regularly. We should chant because we have this genuine understanding that I need Krishna and Krishna consciousness. Or somebody will say, but I really genuinely don't feel such a need. Why are you forcing it upon me? So, consciousness in its most original condition. For example, when rainwater comes, in its most pristine condition, it is actually purest water. But then it comes in contact with mud on the ground, it becomes yellowish or blackish or reddish, depending on what it touches. Similarly, the consciousness of the spirit soul originally is Krishna conscious. But when it comes in touch with Maya, matter, it acquires tamoguna, rajoguna, sattvaguna. And then those needs become prominent in life. So tamoguni people have their needs for intoxication, oversleeping, and irregulated lifestyle. And rajoguni people, they have their sex and money, pass, nothing else beyond this. That's their need. Sattvic people, they have thirst for knowledge, some philanthropic activities. But then these are not true needs of the soul. Originally, is to experience Krishna's affection in our life. So when we are chanting, we can pray to Krishna that let me develop my true needs and value system in my life. We can be begging that I understood theoretically I need to beg. So please help me for properly doing it. Like somebody said to Prabhupada, when I chant Hare Krishna, I don't feel like, you know, crying out for Krishna. What should I do? Prabhupada said, you should cry out, but you don't feel like crying out for Krishna. Make some excuse. And somewhere it will begin. And this is why, when we are chanting now, we will go and focus on this contemplation more. How much do I feel a thirst for this chanting? Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasanta Bhaktavinoda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama Rama Rama
Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna Krishna
So we go to Bhagavad Gita. Please take out your chapter 3. Please recite out here.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
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 Devan bhavayata nena. Parasparam bhavayantah. Shreyam param amapsyath.
This
is text 11. I hope you all have to put together. Translation. The demigods, being pleased by sacrifices, will also please you, and thus by cooperation between men and demigods, prosperity will reign for all. So because we are meeting after a long time, we'll just do a quick overview of this third chapter. We began our discussion for first 9 verses. Karma Yoga versus Karma Tyaga. What is better? Typically, every spiritualist, after he gets introduced to the basics of Krishna conscious or spiritual culture, I am not the body, I am spirit soul, soul's needs are most important, material world is useless. Then suddenly he gets an upsurge of hyperactive spirituality and he starts doing karma tyag. He thinks all this, you know, family maintenance and job, making money, preserving money, expanding money, it's too much headache. These are all needs of the soul. So I better do karma tyag. So that mentality Krishna is addressing. Arjuna thought, wow, I was not wanting to fight this battle anyways, and Krishna is now giving me a wonderful justification that I am not the body, I am spirit soul, and I am supposed to be spiritually conscious. What am I doing with these material things? Fighting a war. Interesting. So Krishna is addressing that typical neophyte mentality. What is his suggestion? Instruction. Not karma tyaga. Karma yoga. Continue doing what you were doing, but now in a divine consciousness. That is called karma yoga. Where you connect your day-to-day routine activities, even simple activities like eating, sleeping, bathing, cooking, working, parenting. But now you do them in Krishna consciousness. And Arjuna is being told that this is how you should do your work. So that was the discussion. Karma yoga is better than karma tyaga. Karma tyaga is artificial. Senses need real engagement. If you don't give proper engagement to the senses, your mind becomes corrupt and you start going in wrong directions. Mithyachara. Mithyachara means hypocritical behavior. And many people in India, you might have seen, who wear dress of a sadhu or sometimes claim themselves to be spiritualists. But then they are eventually found corrupt. Why that happens? Because that person has not truly developed his inner consciousness that sustains the very basis of their renunciation. And artificially they have renounced things out. So, karma yoga takes care that your senses level pakka engaged, but the mentality behind engaging those senses is not purified. To give a simple example, how in our day-to-day work, day-to-day life, we cook. So earlier we used to cook for our own taste. Sometimes we have a habit also, while cooking only people taste it in the middle. But devotees don't do that. They cook for Krishna's pleasure. They know that this, I'll cook nicely and offer it to Krishna. Bhoga. And that's why devotees don't taste when they cook.
And many people are surprised when they come to our temple. How do you make such nice prasad without tasting it in between? And I said, no, we have our, what do you call, superior help. Krishna is helping us, guiding us at every step. And we don't need to do that. So this is the meaning of how one can connect simple, simple activities directly to God. And while doing them and reaping the fruits or the enjoyment of them, one doesn't become entangled in karma bandhana, the chain of action-reaction in this world. So this was the first part. We have discussed that elaborately. And the conclusion of that was in the 9th verse, yadnyasvat karmanaha. One should perform all karma for as a mean of, as an offering to Lord Vishnu, yadnya. Yajnyathat karmanah. Anyatra lokoyam karma bandhanah. And if you perform it otherwise, you will get bondage. Tadartham karma kaunteya. O kaunteya, Arjuna, act for the pleasure of the Supreme. Tat artham. And mukta sangha samachara. Remain always in an ever liberated condition, although staying in this material. Just like a soldier of India who fights on behalf of India has such privileges. You have seen army people, they get such privileges. What is that army depot? Depot, they supplies are quite reduced in prices.
Canteen.
Army canteen, yeah, sorry, I'm sorry. So you get like, a cycle for 500 rupees, brand new cycle. And you get whatever. And they have such privileges sometimes. I have seen often when they come down from their flights or buses or trains, there are powerful vehicles waiting for them. They get such privileges. And of course, they have a responsibility also to discharge proportionately. So, one who does the work of the Lord becomes liberated in this world. He gets all facility to do that work more and more on behalf of God. Sometimes you might have seen when a big politician comes, like a Prime Minister of India or something. Then practically speaking, he's the only guy driving on the road. You see that? Everybody blocks everything. And there are no signals for him. There are no toll tax, he has to pay. He doesn't even wait for it. And then there is a whole... Is it not Mukta Sangha Samacham? when you are doing full-scale work, this is for a small government we are talking. A small country of India, that he has given such a privilege. Now imagine somebody becomes really universal government appointed representative. Universal government meaning now, God-conscious person. Now he is acting in this world, he can do miracles. And he will be scot-free, practically speaking. That doesn't mean he can do anything. But at the same time, he is practically liberated soul, even while in this world. So Srila Prabhupada was one such person. He always acted transcendentally. He was not bound to any laws or this or that. The way you generally conceive of them, one time Srila Prabhupada was walking, it was early morning. I think it was in New York. And there were two disciples of his, I think Satsuru Maharaja and one more. They were walking behind him. And they were very new devotees. They didn't know much about Krishna Vajas. They were just American boys following Swamiji. So, as Prabhupada came across a red signal, which showed that the food-bearing people, they should not walk on a white. It's early morning time. What's the early morning time? Something like 6 o'clock, 6:30. There was not much traffic. So these two boys were walking behind, one of them. He became thoughtful. What would Swamiji do? Because signal is red, you are not supposed to cross. But there is no traffic. So what does spirituality dictate in such a situation? Are you supposed to follow the laws of staying pakka to the T dot? Or you act? And can you imagine how much Prabhupada must be watched by these guys before they surrendered their lives to him? Chota chota game. And then Prabhupada looked at the signal, he turned left, turned right, nothing there, he walked ahead. And that was the day this guy, he said, I will become disciple of this person because he is most practical man on earth today. You know, in the name of so-called following the letter of the law, you lose the spirit of the law. The spirit of the law is no accident. And the letter of the law, you don't cross it there. You know? So it's an interesting thing. So in the same manner, we have to learn how to act in this world in such a way that the tightness of time, the three modes of nature and varieties of other conditionings that are imposed upon us, the tightness becomes loosened. And we become more and more liberated in our action, in our thoughts. And this is called Mukta Sangha Samachana. How many of you would like to become a Mukta Sangha Samachana personality in this? Wow. You are in the right place. I'm doing the right thing. So now we are on text 11. By the way, in text 10, we began an interesting discussion. Typically, we studied Yoga Land. That was another topic. I won't go into that again now. But Yoga Land is basically levels of consciousness and correspondingly activities, occupations that we perform. So, we saw that there is base mentality, like below animals, modern human beings, who don't have any regulation in there. Then there are animalistic level, where you have eating, sleeping, mating, defending that you do with a regulated mind. And then there is karma kand mentality, where for getting my enjoyment, I should not work hard like animals. There are sanctioning authorities in this creation called demigods, devatas, who control various aspects of this creation. So I can just perform some karma kand, and you pay a little and you get your electricity. You pay a little and you get your water. You pay a little and you get your education through them. Whatever you need in life. So that's called karma kand mentality. And above karma kand is karma yoga. He said, why should I pay this middleman? Why not pay to the supreme? Who is supplying even them their, you know, ingredients. So that's called karma yoga. I will act only for the pleasure of the supreme, and whatever comes through that, I'll live my life with it. So Krishna is now going to teach how to go from karma karna to karma yoga in the yoga ladder. How to change that mentality. So we began in that text 10 verse. That creation was made by Lord Brahma, who is the chief engineer of this universe, on the order of the Supreme Lord. And Lord Brahma also gave a system of yajna, karma kanda, through which all the living beings in this world can get their prosperity, get their needs met, especially material needs, not spiritual. So 99% of the Vedas is karma kanda. Where you want some material benefit and you get it through worship of some devata. Why is that so? Because people who come to material world, they don't want to deal with the Supreme Lord. They want to enjoy matter. So as they say, user-friendly manual. Vedas are user-friendly manual. Usko jo chahiye wo de do. Something like that. You want material enjoyment? Here it is. Don't slog hard to get your material enjoyment. This is how you get it. So that's the idea behind karma kanda. So, in the next verse, which is today's verse, Devan bhavayata nena. In this way you please the devatas. Te devan bhavayantu vaha. And they will also please you in return. Parasparam bhavayata. Having scratched each other's backs very nicely. Shreya Parama Vamsatha, you will get all your necessities met in this world. So, what is the status of Devata worship in comparison to Krishna consciousness? People worship in this one Indra, Chandra, Varuna, Vayu, Kubera, various types of Devatas. So, there are 33 crore of them. It's quite a number. That means there are 33 crore departments and so many in charges in the universal affairs. So, devatas are like how if a child goes to a shopkeeper and he gives him 10 rupees and he says, give me a candy. And the shopkeeper just gives it to him. He doesn't ask him, show me your teeth. You know, oh, it's too rotten to teeth there. No Cadbury for you. A shopkeeper won't do that. But if the boy goes to his father and says, Papa, Cadbury, show me your teeth. And no, you won't get it now. Till you fix this up.
So, I want it.
No, beta. You wonder what this kind of parenting is.
So similarly, when you go to Devatas, you quickly get your desires fulfilled, and that is why people will prefer to go to them. Okay, Krishna, pata nahi kya karega, dega nahi dega. So people generally go to Devatas and also get quickly their desires fulfilled. At the same time, it's better for us to go to Krishna. Even if we have material desires, we should go to Krishna. Because Krishna has an amazing way. One time one boy came to one of our, we have our youth hostels that we run, you know, for giving spirituality and leadership training to modern youth. So we get all kinds of boys, engineering boys, medical boys. Almost everybody has a girlfriend nowadays. So this one boy came. He says, Prabhuji, I have one girl in my mind. If I chant Hare Krishna, will I get her? A very frank question. So this teacher told him, whatever your desire, you should go chant Hare Krishna, you should go to Krishna, and Krishna only you should ask. Nobody else you should go to. But then he said, but Prabhuji, how do you say, you know, chant Hare Krishna and be happy? If she doesn't come to me, how will I be happy? Although I chanted Hare Krishna and Krishna didn't, let's say, sanction, then how will I be happy? So this devotee gave an interesting answer. He said, if you chant Hare Krishna and you have such an intensity of desire that this girl be with you, then Krishna will fulfill that desire. And alongside, you will also purify your heart, infusing some spiritual energy by which you become more spiritual in life. That's one possibility. Another possibility is that Krishna will give you this girl and she will frustrate you even more. That you will come back running to Krishna. Both okay, it's okay. It's another way. Third is, Krishna may not, he may say wait. No? That is an interesting thing Krishna does something. Somebody says yes, sanction, no problem. But no. Okay, still alright, you got to at least make it to push Vajra Lila. Then Krishna says wait. Not now. That's another problem. It's like this father's example. Not now. So the point is, Akama Sarva Kamova Moksha Kama Udaradhi Tivrena Bhakti Yogena Yajeta Purusham Param. Whether you are akama, no material desires. Sarva kamova, you're filled with material desires. Moksha kama, you just want to get freed from sufferings that are right now there in your life. What should you do? Tivrena bhakti yogena, with intense bhakti yoga, yajeta purusham param. You should worship the Supreme Person. So this is the injunction of the scriptures. So in any case, Krishna does fulfill what his desires. And you will be amazed to know, as you practice Krishna consciousness, some of the old desires that you made, they do get fulfilled. And the best possible setting, amidst the best possible people, in the best possible manner, and you feel, wow, I never thought like that, that it is possible like this. And that's why, beware of your desires, they might be answered. Oh, sorry, beware of your prayers. They might be answered. So when you are chanting Hare Krishna, especially you should be careful not to make material desires. At least at that time, oh Hare Krishna, please engage me in your service. But in any case, whatever be your intention, go to Krishna and ask him. Dhruva, the 5-year-old boy, he did it. He wanted vengeance. You know, his stepfather insulted him. He wanted a kingdom greater than his great-grandfather, Brahma. And we discussed that story. It's quite a bit of material desire to get something better than a Brahmanda. Well, people have material desires like I want 2 BHK, 5 BHK, or some row house, bungalow, or island in Canada, or some place.
He wanted what?
Bigger than Rama.
And when he went to Vishnu, after getting darshan of Vishnu, he felt what I was asking for are like broken glass pieces in front of a diamond. And the Lord actually persuaded him, I know you came for a purpose. Ask. He said, no. Swamin krutarthosmi varam na yachayat. Now I'm feeling krutartha, fulfilled. I don't want anything. And still the Lord knew what he wanted. You know, despite all this. Sudama Brahman. Poor Brahman. He was staying, I think, somewhere in Gujarat. Poor Bandar area. Where Gandhiji was born. From Sudama. Came from there. And Sudama went to Dwarka because his wife really pushed him hard. Go, your friend is Dwarkadhish. You know, he's an opulent man. What are we living in poverty? He is friend of Brahmanas. He will give charity. So Sudama had no desire to go and beg anything from Krishna, but he wanted to meet him. And he thought this is a good opportunity. So he carries this poha that his wife begs from some neighborhood people and gives him. And Sudama goes to Krishna and he's hiding that from him. Why? Because after seeing the Aishwarya of Dwarka, who will feel giving your gift? Beg this. So Krishna says, so, Bhabhi ne meri liye kuch bheja nahi. And Sudama says, it's very shyly. How will I show even what I have brought? Because when Sudama reaches Krishna's palace, he had such a treatment, VIP treatment. You know, Krishna personally comes running out of his palace, embraces him tightly, takes him inside his personal private chambers, puts him on his own bed, washes his feet with milk and various beautiful items, gulab jamun, and then he feeds him opulent prasadam, and while that he's eating, Rukmini herself is fanning him. Lakshmi, Bhagya Devata, standing beside him. My husband is my friend. So she's fanning him. And Sudama is wondering, what kind of fortune is this? You know, Asman se gire khajur mein atke. You know, there's no worth. And I'm being treated like this. And then Krishna reminds him of his school days, all the wonderful things they did together. And then while leaving, Krishna never asks him, what do you want? Nor does Sudama speak that my wife actually sent for such a purpose. He just doesn't ask anything. And he's just happy in his heart. He's thinking, what a wonderful friend I have got, and what a wonderful meeting this was. And he's just delighting his heart going back home. And while going back, he recites a beautiful prayer. He says, Vaham Daritra Papiya Kva Krishna Shrine Niketana Brahma Bandhu Iti Swaham Bahubhya Param Lobhitah. Kvaham, who am I? Daritra Papiya, sinful wretch. Kva Krishna Shrine Niketana. Who is Krishna? The husband of goddess of fortune. Lakshmi Sahastra Shata Samadhama Sivya Mala. Billions of goddesses of fortune serve him in the spiritual world. And Brahma Bandhu, I am not even a Brahmana. I am just a born in Brahman family but not having any qualification. Brahma Bandhu. Still, Bahubhya Parirambhita. Krishna embraced me with his own arms, which he does only for Balaram and Rukmini, nobody else. As a king, he said, you did that to me. And thinking like this, he finally goes home and there he sees whole Ur Bandar has become jailed. I had to say, this place where he's staying. There are opulent palaces, powerful lawn, beautiful gardens. मतलब घर में जाने के लिए इतना बड़ा garden है, वो garden cross करने में इतना time लगता है. And then Thali reaches a big palace there. And he's wondering, ये कहाँ गया है? पता गलत हो गया, GPS system, you know, some wrong something. And then his wife comes out of the palace. And he can't believe how she's looking, what she's wearing. I don't know. It's because you're fearful also, same lady or not. Because she's too good. And then she comes and falls at his feet and welcomes him home. This is your home. So what happened? He said, I don't know what happened, but suddenly, after you reach there, Dwarka and Krishna eats that poha. And he offers one morsel, he eats his whole. All these finished. He becomes an opulent man. second mausali eats, Krishna eats, Krishna becomes indebted to him because now he has nothing more to offer. So he has to give himself. And he's about to eat the third morsel, that time Rukmini stops. He also gives this, then all the devotees will also become servant of this fellow. You know, including myself. So she pauses him. She said, enough. And then Sudama is thinking, my goodness, what to do now with this wealth? So anyway, it doesn't belong to me, it belongs to Krishna. Let's use it in his service. So in this mood, devotees conduct their affairs in life. So why I told this story specifically, Dhruva and Sudama, is sometimes people have this fear that if I go to Krishna, you know, my material desires will they get fulfilled or not, and my needs will be met or not, and better not take any bangara. No need to fear. Krishna says, sarva dharma parityajya vamekam sharanam aham tvam sarva papebhyo mukshayishyami. There is vamsuchaha. Don't fear. Just do it. It originally comes from Bhagavad Gita. Just do it. So this is the call that the Lord gives, of course, at the end of Bhagavad Gita. Why we are discussing that here? Because sometimes you read a verse without the context around it. What's the conclusion you will draw out of this? We should worship devatas. Krishna is telling in Bhagavad Gita. That's what you think, right? After just reading this one translation. You know, you should please the reward, then give back, and you say both of you get prosperity. This is not the conclusion of Bhagavad Gita, although it appears to be so. And in this way, that runs of land from Karma Kanda to Karma Yoga proceeds. We'll complete 12 and maybe 13. And 14 is a crucial one, we'll continue with this. Ishtan bhogani ho deva dasyante yajna bhavitah tayadattana pradayebhyo yobhunte stena eva sah. Translation.
In charge of the various necessities of life, the demigods, being satisfied by the performance of yajna, will supply all necessities to you. But he who enjoys such gifts without offering them to the demigods in return is certainly a thief.
The basic understanding is we get so many facilities from material nature. Air to breathe, water to drink, grains to eat. Actually, even the home that we build, you know, the ingredients for building a home or a furniture, nothing belongs to us. But yajna performance is necessary to give up our sense of false proprietorship over it. This is what yajna exactly does. Like when somebody opens a new home, we have a housewarming ceremony, Vastu Shanti. What is the purpose? The family is declaring that it is not that we own this home and Krishna is being invited to stay here. Krishna owns this home and we are seeking his permission to stay here and serve him. That is the mood of a devotee. So that is why people have such misconceptions about who they are and what they possess. So to clear that false ego, false conception, proprietorship. And second purpose is to also acknowledge and try to repay the debt. We have so much debt. हम सब भुगते हैं. Simple है. भुगते वालों में preloader कुछ करते हैं एक भुगत खाते हैं. So one has to acknowledge that I need to. I actually get this from such a person, and I want to repay. Of course, we cannot repay, but we make a gesture of wanting to offer some service. In ordinary situation also, if you don't pay your electricity bill, what happens? If you don't pay your mobile bill, what happens? When you don't pay your gas connection bill or whatever. So solar energy, mankind has been using such a billion years nowadays. How many of us paid our tax for Surya Deva? How many? Vayu, everybody is contributing something in our life. Where is our tax? Either tax bharne ke liye nahi bharte to kaat hota hai samajh mein aata hai aur wo log mercifully de rahe hain, hum kya sochte hain
in Marathi they call Phukat Chambu Babu Rao.
Very interesting term.
Phukat Chambu Babu Rao. So we become like that. So Krishna is saying, Tair Dattam Apradayevyo. They have given you something, and if you don't give them back in return, you bhunte. If you enjoy anything in your life, stay in the Evasana. He's a thief. He's punishable by the laws of nature. So that's the meaning. So Prabhupada gives an elaborate explanation in the second paragraph of the purport. One should know, however, that all the necessities of life that the human society requires are supplied by demigod agents of the Lord. No one can manufacture anything. Take, for example, the eatables of human society. Grains, fruits, vegetables, milk, sugar. For persons in want of goodness, and also for non-vegetarians like meat, none of this can be manufactured by man. It comes from nature, which is property of God. Then again, take for example, heat, light, water, air. None of them can be manufactured by human society. Without the Supreme Lord, there can be no profuse sunlight, moonlight, rainfall, breeze, without which no one can live. Obviously, our life is dependent on the supplies from the Lord. Even for our manufacturing enterprises, those of you who have such a industries, we require so many raw materials like metal, sulfur, mercury, materials, all of which are supplied by the agents of the Lord, with the purpose that we should make proper use of them to keep ourselves fit and healthy for the purpose of self-realization, leading to the ultimate goal of life, liberation from material struggle for existence. This is the aim we attain by performance of yajna. So when we don't do this work, charity, yajna, dana, tapa, yajna means sacrifices, dana means charity, tapa means austerity, trying to live a little minimal. There is a new term recently added, frugal in year. Millennials when I live, frugal in year. This person is living frugally and is feeling rich in heart. How many of you have experienced the things that we own, they own us, and they possess us? You know, sometimes people have wardrobe, filled with clothes, shoes. I heard this lady in some Nigerian country's president's wife, she had some 500 chappals. Now when you go inside, you look at that, you feel crazy. You kaunsa pehna? Variety is not mother of enjoyment. After a certain limit, it becomes mother of confusion. So many people are so much, this jewelry, that clothes, this, you know, chappal, whatever. And after some time, enjoyment is not there. Simply to maintain that, you are foaming at your mouth. Trying to take care of all this, to keep it nice, clean, and hardly use anything for yourself. So what you own, owns you in return. And one wants to become liberated after some time. All these false possessions, I have to get rid of them. So that's the basic concept. Yajna, dana, tapa, they are really purifying and we should adopt them in our life. And then the final words for the day. Yajna shishtashina santo Ucchante sarva kilvishaihi Ucchate te tvagam papa Ye pachanti atma karanat. Translation.
In the body of the Lord are released from all kinds of sins because they eat food which is offered first for sacrifice. Others who prepare food for personal sense enjoyment merely eat only sin.
Hare Krishna. I give this example earlier. Let's say you are staying happily in your own home. And some somagone, which means unknown person comes in your home and he comes and brushes you on your sofa and sits next to you. And you're caring, thank you, Chavale. How good? And TV ko bandh. Chavale mode. Chavale browsing.
अरे तेरे को एक समझ नहीं क्या सैंडविच बना के ना तो खुद ही उठ के जाता है वो ब्रिज खोलता है जो लेना है लेना खा खाते हैं खाते उसका टीवी देखते हैं आप क्या बोलोगे उसको मोस्ट माइट थिंग यू वे डू इज टू इजेक्ट हिम आउट ऑफ योर होम सीवियर इज टू गिव टू पुलिस सो व्हेन वी कम इन दिस क्रिएशन वी काइंड ऑफ ऑटोमेटिकली अज्यूम प्रोप्राइटरशिप ऑफ एवरीथिंग अराउंड कि सब मेरे एंजॉयमेंट के लिए बने जानना पहचान मैं तना मैं सो पीपल जस्ट पार्ज इनटू अंडरस्टैंडिंग एंड स्टार्ट यूटिलाइजिंग थिंग्स इन दिस क्रिएशन व्हाटएवर दे कम अक्रॉस एंड दे हैव नो कॉन्सेप्शन दैट दिस बिलोंग्स टू समबडी एल्स वन टाइम व्हेन जैकल ही वेंट इनटू अ कुकुम्बर फील्ड एंड अ लॉट ऑफ कुकुम्बर देयर ही वांटेड टू ईट आल्सो बट ही सेड आई एम अ वेरी ऑनेस्ट जैकल आई डोंट ईट विदाउट परमिशन So he said, I'm going to sit here tight for next 1 hour. And in this 1 hour, if nobody comes and tells me that this field belongs to me and you should not eat cucumber here, then I'm going to eat it. And he sat there, you know, for an hour and nobody came and nothing happened. So he looked left and right. It seems he started eating. Is that logic good? What is the mentality we have got? Americans, they claim to send, you know, the spaceship to moon and the first thing they do when they go on the moon is to put American flag. What a mentality! You know, where are you from? Where are you from? They say, I have put my first leg here. The whole planet is mirror. Hey, what kind of... you understand? What kind of proprietorship mentality have you got? And this is why we are suffering also. Because all this I want to give up at the time of our death. And it is super painful. So better you understand, I am not a proprietor, I am simply a caretaker. It all belongs to somebody else. So when I have to leave it, I have no problem. So this is the first understanding. Why we should offer our food to God? Because all that we do in our life, dunyavandari madhari mari, finally for what? पापी पेट का सवाल है उधर जाके खत्म होता है ना सब्जी फिर तीन टाइम अच्छा खाने मुझे क्योंकि इतना सारा काम किया झगड़ा किया पॉलिटिक्स किया ये किया वो किया फाइनली वेरी टेंस सो व्हेन यू मेक दैट वन थिंग एज एन ऑफरिंग टू कृष्णा इट इज एज गुड एज योर ऑफरिंग ऑल दैट हार्ड वर्क एंड एवरीथिंग इन द सर्विस ऑफ द लॉर्ड दैट इज व्हाई डिवोटी डज नॉट ईट एनीथिंग विदाउट ऑफरिंग इट टू कृष्णा इट इज एज सिंपल एज दिस वन इज टू एक्नोलेज प्रोप्राइटरशिप की मेरा नहीं है आपका है आपकी परमिशन से दो थोड़ा खाने के लिए दैट्स वन वे बट हायर वे इज आउट ऑफ लव जस्ट लाइक अ चाइल्ड ऑन हिज फादर्स बर्थडे ही गेट्स मनी फ्रॉम द मदर गोज एंड परचेजेस अ गिफ्ट ऑर अ चॉकलेट और व्हाटएवर केक एंड देन द पापा कम्स होम आफ्टर द ऑफिस एंड द होल सेरेमनी देयर केक कटिंग एंड गिफ्ट गिविंग And then he feeds also the cake to the father. The father never says, ये केक बनाने का पैसा किसने दिया? मैं मैंने ही दिया. तुम क्या शान है? इतना खुशहाली दिखा रहे हो. There is no such a discussion. Why? It's love. Similarly, Krishna has given everything to us, and we take a portion of that property only and offer it to him. It doesn't say किसने दिया. That's not the point. It's a gesture of love. So. This is why daily whatever food we eat, at least those things are not offerable, we should offer to Krishna and then consume as prasadam. Prasadam, roke sakshat darshan, it's Krishna in food form. Secondly, bhunjate te tugham papa, those who eat for their own tongue's sake, they are eating sin. Ye bachanti atma karana, those who cook for themselves and eat for themselves, what are they eating? Sin, because it doesn't belong to them in first place. So that's the understanding. Now, so sunal ki ek loha ki, isn't it? If you just separate these two things in your life, take prasadam every day and chant Hare Krishna every day. These are like ek loha ki. Everything else in your life will become set right. Your consciousness, your thoughts, your words, your actions, your success, your love, your contribution to flourish. It all begins with tongue. Tongue is the radar of the human body. What your tongue is chirping and what your tongue is tasting decides your existence, your consciousness. And a devotee takes full charge of this radar. बोले इसको कभी गड़बड़ नहीं करने देने का, फालतू गड़बड़ नहीं, फालतू क्या कहते हैं उसको, मंचिंग, फालतू कचरा नहीं खाना है, खाना है तो प्रसाद. सो वंस यू मेक अ दैट डिटरमिंड वाउ, एवरीथिंग हैज बिकम वंडरफुल. थैंक यू वेरी मच. एनी कमेंट्स और क्वेश्चंस?
वन क्वेश्चन व्हिच मेड सम दैट इज बीइंग थिंग्स आर बीइंग फोर्स्ड बी
What is over simplified?
I just asked that we are talking about baby gods, you know, offering you honey and performing yajnas. Don't you think it's all symbolic? In the sense,
why would it be given here?
Prabha, I don't know that.
Why would Krishna recommend something that is just symbolic and not practice?
I don't understand. What I'm trying to say is that they are trying to tell us that you should give your hard-earned money or whatever it is to charity, to reduce the misery in the world of the human beings, the animals, and whatever it is. And that is the essence of all this. And then only you are justifying in giving, or you can teach a peaceful mind, or you know, what they call it, self-realization. But this is for you here. So the procedures of Yajna is
that are ultimately aimed at
yes, this is what the natural
ecological balance maintenance.
Something like that.
It is true that we should give charity for noble causes, no doubt about it. However, our human energy and the production of it, money, whatever we have, has to be first employed in watering the root of the creation. Krishna is the root of the creation, and when you water the root of the tree, everything in the tree becomes nourished. But if you simply go on putting water on the branches and the twigs and the leaves, independent of the root, you will still see that the tree dies if you don't put the water at the root.
And what is exactly meaning by
that? That means that this Yajna Dana Tapa has to be performed first for the cause of the Supreme Absolute Truth. You have a famous story how Durvasmani comes to Pandavas suddenly with his 60,000 disciples when they are in the jungle. And Draupadi has nothing. So after that, she has eaten from the Akshaya Patra and is kept aside. And then Krishna comes to their rescue and he says, give me something from it. And he eats one shark. And when Krishna is fulfilled, just that one offering, small offering, Yasmin Tushtam Jagat Tushtam, all the Durvasmani, all the disciples, they are full. They don't know where their stomachs have become full from. And then Krishna says, Bhima to get them back. Go and tell them food is ready. And Bhima puts his gada on and says, Durvasmane, please come. And you see him come like that. They are, Durvasmane has earlier experience with offending Ambarish Maharaj, one pure devotee. And he suffered like anything. And now he's thinking, my goodness, they have prepared meal now, and if you don't go and eat properly, another offense. They simply run away. He was wondering, why, what happened, why did he just calling them that already? So the point I am making is, if you water the root of the tree, everything becomes nourished. But you cannot devise a system to separately sprinkle your water here and there without reference to the root. It will not nourish anything. So that's the point.
Sankirtana
Yajna is when you employ all your resources to just make a good facility for hearing and chanting about Krishna. That is what Sankirtan Yajna. So we earn money, we have a nice home, we have everything else set. But what do we do with that? That daily we should spend some quality time hearing about Krishna and chanting the holy names of Krishna. This is called Sankirtan Yajna. And this wonderful facility, Siddharth and Shri Jan making available to us, they are performing a grand Yajna. Not only they themselves are doing nicely, but they are actually making facility for so many. So, thank you all very much. Shri Padma Bhagavad Gita, Jai.